Revelation chapter 5. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Revelation chapter 5. We're going to read the whole chapter. Amen. If you don't have a Bible and you want one, we got some on that desk back there, some King James Version Bibles. And I titled this morning's message, The Horn of the Lamb, or The Horns of the Lamb. And we're going to start reading in chapter 5, verse 1. It says, "And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? Amen. And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders saith unto me, Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne, and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And he came and he took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and 24 elders," some translations would say instead of beasts, "the four living creatures, and the 24 elders, fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sung a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. And I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beasts and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000s and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth," let's just think about this, what's going on in heaven right now. He said in verse 11, "And I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne and the beasts and the elders," everybody in one, in unison, "and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000s and thousands upon thousands, and they all have one voice and they're all in unity," verse 12, "saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb." Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven, and on the earth, and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, heard I saying, Blessing and honor and glory and power." I'm talking about every created being, amen? Everything that creeps on the ground, everything that has four legs, everything that swims in the ocean. I've said it before and I'll say it again. That's why the bird sings on the branch. He longs, all creation groans, awaiting for the redemption of the sons of men. This is the time now where we're nearing the end, and all, everything that you've experienced in your short little time frame, and everything that human history has experienced from the beginning to the end, it's all coming down to this right here. Who's going to be able to open up the seals? Who's going to be able to let God's plan move forward? And all creation cries out, "Worthy is the Lamb." In verse 13, "Every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea and all that are in them, heard I saying, Blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sits upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever." And the four beasts said, "Amen." And the 24 elders fell down and they worshiped him that lives forever and ever. Father, we just thank you again, Lord. Precious Jesus, we thank you for the reading of the holy word of God. Lord, it speaks truth to our heart, Lord. It tells us, Lord God, it brings us back to reality. People would say, no, this can't be reality. This isn't what I see with my eyes and touch with my hands and hear with my ears. My physical senses tell me something different than what this book that you're saying is real tells me. I'm here to tell you, child of God, this is the reality that we read right here. This is more real than the very thing you're sitting on right now. In the name of Jesus, Holy Spirit, I pray that you'd give us eyes to see and ears to hear, that you'd prepare the soil of our heart to receive the seed of your word, oh Lord God. Lord, I pray that you'd break through, Lord God, our preconceived notions, Lord, and our preconceived understandings, Lord, and that you'd interrupt our life right now, this morning, Lord, that you'd break in, Lord God, and that you'd reveal truth to us. Holy Spirit, I pray that you'd speak this morning what you desire spoken. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, look, so last week I introduced you to some of the concepts. I got a map right here. I have underlined right there Patmos, because that's the island that John the Revelator was on whenever he wrote or received the vision when he began to write the book of Revelation. The Holy Spirit, Jesus was given the revelation by God concerning himself. An angel revealed it to John while he was exiled on the Isle of Patmos. So the Isle of Patmos was an island below. These are the seven churches of the book of Revelation. And you see them right there in that area called Asia Minor. I'm going to step outside the camera for a second. And I just want to just show you some reference points. Because, you know, it's important. I say this a lot. I don't mean to be redundant. But, you know, once again, if I tell you to go to Centerville, you know where Centerville is. But whenever I tell you that Jesus went down to Jerusalem and he was in Jericho, you don't necessarily know what that means. Does it mean he was north of Jerusalem? Or does it mean topographically? Was Jericho higher in elevation and he went down? Some of that stuff matters. You know, for instance, one time whenever Jesus was up here in the area of Galilee, his brothers told him, go down to Jerusalem to the feast and show yourself if you be who you say you are. And the Bible says that Jesus went. One of the things you'll realize if you look at the story, he traveled all the way from Galilee to Jerusalem, and it looks like he was all by himself. And you know, one of the things that I preached on that is that sometimes you're going to be by yourself in the midst of this thing, but you need to know something. You'll never be able to be by yourself because the Lord will always be with you. Jesus had the Father with him, amen? He didn't have the disciples with him. His own brothers told him, go down to Jerusalem and reveal yourself if that be who you say you are. And sometimes you might try to call the pastor and he doesn't answer. I'm glad I answered yesterday. I know that one. But anyway, hallelujah. Oh, if you weren't in here, you missed it. The brother just walked up there and got saved. Hallelujah. Well, anyway, so what I want you to see, though, is that this is Jerusalem, and then this is Asia Minor. Now, I'm into maps, and I'm into geography, and I can't even just begin to tell you the amount of history that's behind this strip of land. It's known as an isthmus, right? It's a strip of land that connects two land masses, and it's in the midst of water. This is the east. Right here, going back, you got Iraq, you have Iran, and down here you have Egypt. So this is the east, and this is the west. This is Greece, and this is Italy, and this is where the Roman Empire started. And so this landmass right here connected the east to the west. If you can imagine the Roman armies going across here. Nevertheless, this is where the seven churches of Asia Minor are. And in one of these little small islands somewhere about 30 miles south of Ephesus on this isle called Patmos is where John the Revelator is being. He's been banished. He's been isolated to this island for the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ and his preaching of the gospel. And so there he was sitting on the isle whenever he received the revelation. Amen. And he begins to write these things down. Now, where we are in this chapter 5 is that he's already told us about the church age. We talked a little bit about that last week. He talked about those seven churches already and the messages that he was to deliver to those churches. And each one of those churches received a commendation, and or sometimes they didn't even have a commendation, meaning that God was pleased with some things they were doing, but then there was also some condemnation. And that's really true for each and every one of our lives. Amen. I think we can all admit that even as Christians, there's been some good things and there's been some bad things. And the Lord would tell them, strengthen that which is good and get rid of that which is bad. Amen. And so really and truly, one of the things that we talked about from a pre-tribulation standpoint is that the messages to these churches represent really really the entirety of the church age also. Yes, there were seven literal churches in Asia Minor, but it also represents the time frame known as the church age. And so at the end of that, at the end of chapter 3, the Word of God says in chapter 4, after this, I heard a voice as the sound of a trumpet, and it said, come up hither. And the next thing you know, John's caught up in the Spirit. He's caught up in the Spirit, and he's in heaven. And now he begins to tell us what it is that he sees. And one of the things that he's seeing right here, he's about to tell us in chapter 5, before the seals can ever be touched, he tells us some things that are taking place in chapter 5. And one of the things that he says is, as he saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne, there was a book. And in that book, there was also seven seals that were located. And then the next thing you know is that the angel with a strong voice proclaims with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? Now, as I began to study this passage of Scripture, I began to think, as far as for what's really going on in heaven right now. I mean, I try to step back. I try to look at it from far. I try to look at it up close. And one of the things that I have to come to the realization of is that we're at the end now. I mean, yes, we see various things taking place on the earth today. And I think that many of us would agree that it seems like we're nearing the end, or we're in the end days, right? But what I'm saying is that in this passage of Scripture, no, we're at the end. Whenever that is, whether it's in 1 year, 2 years, 10 years, 20 years, whatever the case, when you hit here, what John is seeing is he's seeing the end. And what I need you to understand is, the first thing I want you to see is that in my introduction is that God has a plan. And I know I say this a lot, but look, from way back when, and I don't know if I put this, there we go, from the garden, from the fall, beginning in the fall, all the way to the seals. All this time frame, thousands of years of human history. God working a plan. I talk to you about this all the time. But God pulled mankind, born of Adam, fallen in sin, has a sinful nature, cannot have relationship with God. How many times did we talk about what God did when he expelled Adam and Eve from the garden? He put two cherubim with flaming swords representing judgment, preventing their ability to get back into the garden where the presence of God dwelt. And so now we see, because of the sinfulness of man, a separation from God and his presence. And immediately God goes to work. And the plan that he goes to work with is, what does he do? He takes the skins of an animal and he clothes Adam and Eve with the skins of an animal. Now, I don't know what your preacher that you grew up in church told you about those skins. He probably didn't even say nothing about them. He might not have. But what I'm telling you is that Adam and Eve tried to clothe themselves with fig leaves. The work of man's hands, attempting to cover his nakedness, attempting to cover his sinfulness. And in reality, your working of religion and your working of good works will not cover your sinfulness. I'm telling you right now, any lying religion that tells you that you can do better stuff in order to make yourself right in the eyes of God is completely contrary and a slap in the face to Jesus, because the whole purpose of the shedding of blood on that innocent animal was that it would typify and it would paint a portrait telling us that there was coming a day when there was going to be a lamb that was slain before the foundation of the earth. Hallelujah. And that him alone, his righteous blood being poured out, him alone, his death in our stead and in our place, paying the penalty of sin and bringing reconciliation and restoration back between a holy God and sinful man. If you can't buy into that gospel, then you're not in the gospel. And so that innocent animal, just like Jesus, had nothing to do with their sin. He was slain, and his skins were used to clothe and to cover Adam and Eve. That was the plan from the beginning. But God, methodical, progressive. A day is like, one day with the Lord is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day. And you and I, we got this little vapor, maybe 60 years, 70 years, 80 years, if we take care of ourselves. And you know, we just think that so much time has passed by, and God's over here patient, long-suffering, refusing to detour, refusing to go another way. Oh, mankind's going all kinds of different ways and pathways and figuring out the church. Oh, we got new stuff coming on in the church. All day, all, you know, left and right. It needs to have that thing. I remember Scott and I used to talk about it. The promise keeper. That's how you're going to get victory. Now, I'm not trying to pick on one. You do what you want with that. But the answer was that you get yourself a friend. They wanted me to start one of them groups at another church. I'm like, look, dude, do you want my phone number? I'll give you my phone number. Call me up. We'll talk. We'll pray. But you don't need to confess all your sins to me. Because the truth is that if you're bound up by something, you're not going to tell me about it anyway. Just like I don't need to confess my sins to you. I need to learn how to give it to Jesus. Amen. I need to learn how to trust in Him and let Him do the work that needs to be done.
Yeah.
Can't keep no promise to a man. You can't even keep a promise to Jesus. Jesus is the promise keeper. He's the one that's obedient. He's the one that's righteous. Although the church will find all kind of new little groovy things to go off on, but the Word of God is the same. Amen. From the beginning in the clothing of skins to the end, ain't nobody worthy. The heaven is sitting there waiting because we're nearing the end. And the question is, who is worthy? But God had a plan and He called a man named Abraham. The plan is still in Abraham's story, right? Take your son, your only son. He said, bring him up on a mountain and I'll have you sacrifice him. And the Word of God says that Abraham laid wood on the lad's back. And he carried up a hill called Mount Moriah. And there he was going to be offered as a sacrifice. And the Lord stayed Abraham's hand. I believe that the Lord had a conversation with him and said, you don't have to kill your only begotten son because I'm going to send my only begotten son to die in place of sinful humanity. And that's where God preached the gospel in advance according to what the Apostle Paul said in Galatians chapter 3, 2,000 years after Abraham. God preached the gospel in advance to Abraham. He gave him an illustrated sermon when he asked him to bring his only begotten son up on a hill and to sacrifice him because God said that's what it's going to require. You don't have to believe the book if you don't want to. Throw it on the shelf. This is the plan of God. God allowed Abraham to have a son named Jacob, and God changed Jacob's name to Israel. Hallelujah. What a beautiful story. Amen. That's the gospel story. See, the name Jacob means supplanter, heel snatcher, or deceiver. Israel means one prince of God or one who will rule with God. You got a name change. See, you might have been born one way with one name, but when you get born again in Christ, the old man dies, a new man is resurrected. God wants to change your name. He wants to change your nature, the very being on the inside of you, the root system. Hallelujah. And if and when the root system's changed, amen, and we continue to walk with the Lord, we begin to see the fruit also changed. And so not only was he a man that had a name change to Israel, but he had 12 sons who became the nation of Israel. You remember that? They were in Egypt 400 years and they swelled to a great nation and they left on the Exodus and went through the Red Sea. They entered in and there was a lot of history after that. But ultimately what I want you to know is that through Israel, God gave us Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
And through the cross, the giving of his life, the shedding of his blood, and then the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit, the church age was birthed. And there we've been for the last 2,000 years, and now in our story, we're at the time frame of the seals. The seals have to be opened. See, this is the plan of God. God's plan is never going to change. But now in our story, we're at the end. And God's plan has to move forward. You have to understand that. It can't be stalled. It has to move forward. And the angel proclaims in a loud voice and says, who is worthy? Who is worthy to open the scroll, to look upon the book? Who is worthy to open the seals? And the Word of God says that no man in heaven. No man in heaven. No man on earth. Neither was there anybody under the earth. No one was worthy. No one was able to open the book. No one was able to look upon the book. No one was able to open up the seals. Because, listen to me, the Word of God says if you believe in a pre-tribulational rapture, then these elders represent the raptured church and even the Old Testament saints. And they're clothed in white raiment, meaning the righteousness of God. And they have golden crowns, the victor's crown, the Stephanos, on their heads. And so according to 1 Corinthians 15, that would mean that they've already received their glorified bodies. I'm trying to make a point. Just as Jesus, when he resurrected from the dead, received a glorified body, walls could not contain him anymore. Hallelujah. He still had flesh and bone and he was able to eat, but things were different. Just as Jesus in his resurrected form received a glorified body, we are promised, according to 1 Corinthians 15, that we will also receive a glorified body. And theoretically, these elders are in heaven and they have received their glorified body. And guess what? Still, no one is worthy. No one is worthy to look upon the books. No one is worthy to open up the seals. And the result of that, I can only imagine the weight that must have been on John's heart, on John's mind, the burden that he must have felt at that moment in time. What are you talking about? Because he sees things so clearly right now. None of us in this room have ever been able to see as clearly as John the Revelator at that moment in time was able to see. He's the one that walked so closely with the Lord and he laid his head upon his chest. He's the one that the scripture says in the Gospel of John that the Lord loved him. And now he's been called into heaven. You see, I have a sneaky suspicion that every last one of us in this room think we're doing a whole lot better than what we really are.
Yeah.
The reason I say that is because we compare ourselves in the midst of a fallen world. You understand what I'm saying? That's been stripped away. John's standing there. The holiness of God has been revealed. Hallelujah. The nakedness of man has been revealed. All self-righteousness, every thought that he might have ever thought about something that he did good has been ripped away from him, because now he stands in front of the throne of the Lamb that has been slain, and everything has been laid bare before it. See, it's no longer, I'm doing pretty good compared to old boy. I'm doing pretty good compared to this one over here. And the things that we think in our own hearts and in our own minds, it's been stripped away. I'm sure that John realizes at this point in time that sees God's love towards humanity. There's no more confusion over, but God, he doesn't really love the Buddhist if he's going to send them to hell. Because you see, that's part of what the seals being open represent. You got to understand that. The seals being opened is going to release judgment on the earth. There's going to be people that have refused to believe the word of God. But yet God created a plan and he gave man a free will to make a choice. And not just any choice. He gave him an informed choice. He gave him his word. But instead of receiving his word, they rejected his word. And I've got to tell you something. That part of God's plan requires that sin be judged. And there's coming a day when the seal is going to be opened. And when it does, it represents countless souls slipping into eternal damnation. And whenever that seal is opened up, it represents countless untold pain, untold sorrow. Nevertheless, in order for God's plan to move forward, the seals must be opened. I was sharing yesterday when we were over there, and I know I've told it to y'all before. How many times have I talked to people and they're like, how can you love a God that sends people to hell? I can remember whenever I talked to that girl, and she was a Buddhist. She was like, people are misrepresenting Jesus. Jesus was all about love. Even a Christian, about 3 weeks after that, Jesus was all about love. Well, yes, he was all about love. Of course he was. He laid his life down. He shed his blood. He poured, he breathed his last breath and said, it is finished. That's love like no man's ever seen before. And I remember I was talking to a student that was in the room when I was having a conversation with that Christian woman. And when I walked out, I said, did you count how many times that woman said that Jesus is love? I said, I didn't count it, but it was a lot, wasn't it? He said, yeah, it was. I said, I got a question for you. If the story that I was telling in there is true, basically the seals, I didn't say the seals, but the seals got to be open. And when the seals are open, judgment is coming. And when judgment is coming, people are going to perish. And so my question to him was this. Is it love to just ignore that? Is it love for me out of fear that I'm going to offend you just not to say anything? Or that you might think I'm weird, so just don't say anything and let you just go about your business? Or is true love to tell the truth?
Amen.
Just like even Jesus would do. See, people are like, oh, Jesus is love. So I remember I told that woman, I didn't plan on all this, but I remember I told that woman, I said, well, what did Jesus tell the Pharisees, the religious folk? He called them a bunch of whitewashed tombs filled with dead men's bones. He told Peter, get thee behind me, Satan, for you savor not the things of God, but the things of men. Now you think that Jesus is just all sweet. He took a cord, he took a whip, and he bound up a whip, and he drove out the money changers in righteous anger because they had made the Father's house instead of a house of prayer, a den of thieves. Yeah. Don't tell me. God, Jesus isn't what everybody's making him out to be. Jesus is the person that's in this book right here. Amen. And you know, all you got to do is open it up and you can see him.
Amen.
The seals have to be opened. And it's painful. But in order for the plan of God to move forward, the seals have to be opened. And there's no man in heaven. And there's no man on earth. And there's no man under the earth that's worthy to open up the seals. And John says, I wept much. John said, I wept much because no man was worthy to open or read the book or to look thereon. The word weeping, it doesn't just describe the trickle of a tear, but it describes every external manifestation of grief, wailing, lamenting, tears streaming, probably the beating of the breast, everything that you could ever imagine over grieving of loss. He's being emotional right now. He's experiencing thousands and thousands of years of human history. He's experiencing thousands and thousands of years of God's plan moving from the beginning towards the end. And his heart is broken because he sees the condition of mankind. He sees that no man is worthy. So many times I believe that we think that we're worthy. I know the Lord's been showing me that. Who do you think you are, preacher? You think you've arrived? You think you've showed up somewhere? And the Word of God would say in Romans chapter 3, and you don't have to turn there, but I'll read it to you. It says in Romans chapter 3, verse 10, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understands. Oh, you already offended me, preacher. I'm just reading from the book. There's none that seek after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that does good. No, not one. Their throat is an open sepulcher or tomb. With their tongue they have used deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways. And the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatsoever things the law says, it says to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. The law makes man aware of what sin looks like. The point is this, is what he's saying. It's not to say that you've never done anything good in your life. It's not to say that you never even did a good deed. But to be truthful, if we're honest with one another, many times when we do good deeds, there's even wrong motives behind that. Mm-hmm. We're wanting to be seen or perceived by another person in a particular light. I'm not saying that it's even always that way. What I'm trying to say is that the scripture's trying to say, when you really dig down and you start dissecting and you dig deep down into the heart of a man, you begin to realize what's really on the inside of there. And John is weeping because he sees the condition of mankind, and God's plan needs to move forward. And we're at a standstill, and he weeps. But hallelujah, one of the elders comes to John and he says, weep not. I was just thinking to myself when I read that, those are the most beautiful words. The most beautiful words that human ears could have ever heard. In the midst of so much seeming hopelessness, in the midst of so much pain, to realize that God had such a beautiful plan and installed because mankind was altogether undone, unworthy. And the feeling of, where's any hope left? But all of a sudden, out of nowhere, one of the elders says, weep not. What do you mean, weep not? Nobody's worthy. Weep not because, hallelujah, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the book. I have good news for you this morning. You might feel like you've gone so far and there's no hope in your life, but I have good news. The Word of God says, okay to weep. Crying is for a time. Weeping is for for a moment, but you need to understand, weep not, the Lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed. Hallelujah. Yes, you're unworthy. Yes, I'm unworthy, but we serve a God that has a beautiful plan, and He's made us worthy in Christ.
Amen.
So I want you to see right here two scriptures. It's supposed to be a scepter. Truthfully, ancient scepters look more like a shepherd's hook, which is a whole other story in and of itself. Two scriptures. It said, why am I even going to these scriptures? Because it said, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Let me see if I can get it to do what I want it to do. The Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed. Genesis 49:10, the scepter, the king's staff, shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh comes. The word Shiloh means, literally, the rabbis say, to the one to whom it belongs. So what is that scripture saying? The scepter or the king's staff shall not depart from Judah. Now Judah's way over here. Jacob had four sons with Leah. And one of those sons was Judah. He was number three. Judah, Leah's son, Jacob and Leah's son, Judah. So we're talking probably somewhere around, still around 2000 BC. And then probably about 1,000 years later, during the time frame of the kings, after Israel was a nation, 1000 BC, the second king was David. Two promises in these scriptures right here that are fulfilled and actually spoken of in the Revelation text that we're talking about. Genesis 49, 2,000 years beforehand, the scepter or the king's staff will not depart from Judah, the tribe of Judah, until Shiloh comes, until the one to whom it belongs, till it rests in his hand. And then in 2 Samuel 7, speaking of King David, when your days, whose days, King David, are fulfilled and you go to sleep with your fathers, he said, I will set up your seed after you. I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish his throne of his kingdom forever. An eternal king, an eternal throne, thousands of years before it ever came to pass, prophesied by the prophets, prophesied through Jacob, that it was coming. And in the end of the days, whenever there's nobody worthy, and all of the head, and John is weeping and weeping, the word of God says that one of the elders says, weep not, for the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He says, first off, he says, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the seed of David, he has prevailed. And so the idea of behold literally means, it literally means lo, look. So John's being told by the elder, hey, look over there. Look at this lion. You need to look at this Lion of the tribe of Judah, because he has prevailed. I want you to see, my point number one is that the lamb prevailed. I thought you said it was a lion. We're going to get there. Give me a second. The lamb prevailed. The word prevail means to carry off the victory. You know, they got a lot of ancient Greek gods. I thought this was interesting because I study all that stuff too. This word right here in the Greek is Nikeia. You know where it comes from? The root of it is Nike. Which was a Greek god, but the idea is the idea of conquest and victory and success. This word is descriptive of the conquest of the true king. Amen. He prevailed. He carried off the victory. The lamb prevailed. How did he prevail? Well, I want to turn real quick to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. How did the lamb prevail? Colossians chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. I'm just going to read them real quick. I'm going to start in verse 13, actually. Colossians 2, and we're going to read verses 13 through 15. And you, he's talking about believers, specifically to the church in Colossae, but this is for us today. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh. You remember what circumcision was, right? Seal of the covenant with the Old Testament. That was a circumcision that was provided by the hands of man to show that they were in covenant with God. But in the New Testament, there's a circumcision that takes place of a man's heart whenever he walks up to the front and he gives his heart to Jesus and he receives the Lord Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. The Holy Spirit moves into his life and in his heart, and he performs a circumcision of the heart. He begins to cut away flesh. He begins to cut away things that are on the inside of a man that are contrary to the things of God. And so it says right here, in the uncircumcision of your flesh, but in other words, before you weren't walking with God, he's quickened you or brought life together with him, and he forgave you of your trespasses. He blotted out the handwriting of ordinances. What is that? That's talking about the law. The handwriting of ordinances is the law. The law of Moses. The law of God. That was contrary to us. In other words, the ordinances that were against us, which were contrary to us. Well, why was the law against us? Because we broke it? Because just like Romans chapter 3 said, we're all guilty. We're all unrighteous in the eyes of God. Because why? Because we're all born of Adam. And so we're all, these ordinances were contrary to us. Even if you tried to keep the first 9, you still wanted something that wasn't yours. Come on. It goes on to say right here in verse 14, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances or the law which was against us and contrary to us, he took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. So the law called you and I guilty. Jesus became flesh, sinless flesh. He lived life to perfection, kept the law of God. Oh, there might be times you think he broke the law, but no, he did something that the Pharisees didn't want him to do, but he never broke the law of God. And then he took that perfect life. Whenever we take communion, what do we say? He was the manna from heaven. He was the bread from heaven. He had no leaven in him. He had no sin in him. He allowed his sinless life to be paid as a debt for your sin. He died on the cross. So he kept the law and he died keeping the law. And so now that the law was contrary and called you guilty, now it no longer calls you guilty because Jesus kept it for you.
Amen.
That doesn't mean that you can just go do whatever it is that you think you want to do. No. The point is, first off, you need to understand Jesus is the law keeper. And if we'll learn that, and we'll learn to rest in his work, he'll give us the grace and strength that we need in order to live right. Amen. Amen. Lord, help us. Amen. And it goes on to say right here in verse 15, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Over who? Principalities and powers.
Amen.
Whose principalities and powers? Fallen angels and demon spirits. I don't know if anybody else ever told you that, but you need to hear it. Fallen angels and demon spirits, principalities and powers. You're not in a war against flesh and blood. This might be too much for you. I remember the first time that it wasn't long after I moved down here from Morgan City. I just come out of a rock concert. And you know, my sister and Danielle were in there, and they were talking about demons. I was like, man, y'all are crazy. Y'all have lost y'all's mind. Demon spirits? Really? Come on, man. Y'all take that somewhere else. I believe. And you need to understand that there's power behind sin. There's power behind sin that drives mankind to go in a certain direction. Yes. You can try to work any kind of old program you want to, but if they kick Jesus out the house, brother, you're going to have a problem.
Amen.
Because you can stay, quote unquote, sober for 30 years. And I've seen a man do it. And he got up and he spoke eloquently. He, like what King James would say, he waxed eloquently in his nice clothes. And he spoke about the pitter-patter of all his beautiful children. And now his mind was sober and he could hear the sound of the little pitter-patter of their feet. And he could see the joy on their faces as they sucked on a lollipop. And that's all good and fine and dandy. But the truth of the matter is, you ain't going to tell me you're free in your heart, brother. Because you opened that whole thing up with, my name is such and such, and I'm an alcoholic. Amen. You're still holding on to the old man. And I'm here to tell you that the word of God says the old man is dead. He died in Christ. He was buried in him. And a new man has been resurrected to newness of life.
Amen.
That's the word of God.
Amen.
And if they don't like it, then they don't have to.
Amen.
But I'm here to tell you that you need to hold on to Jesus, amen, and understand that there's a power behind the forces of evil, behind sin, that will try to cling its claws on the inside of you. And the only way to get set free is through the blood of the Lamb. The Word of God says the law was against you. Jesus nailed it to His cross, and then He triumphed over them. He made a spectacle of them. Who's them? Fallen angels and demon spirits. They saw Him when He ascended. They saw it in the heavenly realm as He ascended as the victorious King. Death couldn't hold Him down because it had no right on Him, because He had no sin in Him. He came off the ground. Resurrection life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So I want you to know that's what this picture is. It's hard to see it, I'm sure, but it's supposed to be a Roman parade, because that's what the idea is in the Greek right there. When it says they triumphed over them, the idea, the wording there, is like a Roman parade. Whenever a Roman general would conquer another empire, they would actually take, you can't see it, but this is, I'm about to show you right here. I got a little move I'm about to put on you. This guy right here, he's supposed to be the leader of the other people that they conquered. And they would strip him of all of his armor, and they would parade him into Rome. And all of the citizens would sit there and cheer their general that had won. The idea in the Greek language is that that's what happened in the heavenly realm. Jesus made a show of them. He triumphed over them. He made a spectacle of them. He destroyed them. They thought they had something planned. They put Him on a cross, and that was the very plan from the foundation of the earth. Hallelujah. A lamb that was slain. And then He came busting out the grave. Hallelujah. And so what I want you to know is this, is that that man was a vanquished king. And I'm here to tell you that the enemy of your soul that tries to hold you down, he's also been defeated. Hold on and look to Jesus and don't let go, and trust Him each and every day. It might take a little while. Hallelujah. It doesn't always happen all at once. But don't change your mind about the gospel. Hold on to Jesus and the shedding of His blood. The Lamb prevailed. I want you to know that. But also I want you to know this. I want you to see the close proximity between the Lion and the Lamb. You remember what it said? It said, "Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, He has prevailed." But then the Word of God tells us this. So number one, the Lamb prevailed. Number two, the Lamb has power. This is what the Scripture says. It says, "Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah." He's looking for a lion, right? Isn't that what He said? He said, "Behold." It means, look over there. And He said, "I went to go look. I'm looking for a lion," because that's what He told me to look for, a lion. And He said, "What did I see?" He said, "I saw a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth." So He's looking for a lion, but He sees a lamb, and not just any kind of lamb, but a lamb that was slain. And I'll admit this picture maybe looks a little bit different. But the idea is that it has seven horns, seven eyes, it's slain, and it's got the seals right there. It's worthy. One of the things that I want you to know about horns is this, is that horns represent power, and they also represent anointing. And really and truly, the two are synonymous, because it's God's power through the anointing. Amen? I think I'm going to preach about anointing next week. Don't hold me to it, but I think I'm going to preach that passage of Scripture that talks about how the yoke is broken through the anointing. You've heard preachers talk about that all the time, but they probably never really explained it a whole lot. I think we're going to explain it next week. What does it mean for the yoke to be broken under the power of the anointing? But look at this. Psalm chapter 18, verse 2. Psalm 18, verse 2. I'm just going to read verse 1. "I will love thee, O Lord, my strength." See, it's talking about strength. "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler," that's a small shield, "and the horn of my salvation, and my high tower." And in this psalm, these first couple of verses, it's talking about strength. And I want you to know that the horn is connected to strength. I'm about to prove that to you in a second. But before we do that, I also want to read to you something out of 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13, about the anointing.
What was that again?
1 Samuel 16, verse 13. says right here in 1 Samuel 16, verse 13, it says, "Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward." You know, I love this story and I tell it all the time. But you know, in the beginning of this psalm, the Lord tells Samuel, he says, "Why you keep on mourning over Saul? Saul's disobeyed me. You fill your horn with oil and go down to Bethlehem, and I want you to anoint one of Jesse's boys." Now, one of the things that's interesting is this, is that he told him already, he said, "Don't look at his stature or his appearance, because I've rejected him already. Man looks at the outward appearance, I look at the heart." God knew that whenever Samuel showed up and saw David's oldest brother Eliab, who was tall like Saul, he was going to automatically think that that was the right king. Samuel had to go through every last one of them brothers to find out, is there not any more? Come to find out, it was the little ruddy-cheeked boy that was in the field with the sheep. And whenever they called him, that's what the word of the Lord says. I want you to see this first. This is the word horn, right out of that passage that this is out of my Bible app. Horn. Look at these two definitions. First, strength. Figuratively, the horn speaks of strength. Secondly, it speaks of a flask of oil. It talks about the anointing. I want you to know that it's about strength and it's about the anointing. That's what the horn is all about. The lamb had seven horns. That's why the altar had horns on its corners. It represents power. The altar is representative of the Old Testament cross, the place where the animal was sacrificed. There's power in the sacrifice. The lamb was slain. You understand that? The plan of God. It's never changed. All you got to do is dig a little bit and look for it, and you can see it. There's power, hallelujah, in the cross. Amen. And there's in the anointing of the oil. And this is just a picture of David right here. Look at his brother right there to the right. That's got to be Eliab. Look at how he's looking at it. When in the next chapter, when David goes and brings cheese and wine to his brothers over there because they're over there cowering in the camp when Goliath's speaking down to him, Eliab says, "What have you come down here to do with your impudent little heart?" He's so full of arrogance and pride and bitterness towards his brother because David's been anointed king. Mm-hmm. But do you see again another picture? A couple of weeks back I talked about how God does things, how it almost doesn't make any sense to the it doesn't. To the logical mind, it doesn't. Right. We see these churches so filled, and listen, I'm not fussing about that, man. Look, I don't want 1,000 people up in my church. Can you imagine dealing with that? Mm-hmm. And not even preaching the truth and trying to get people free from some kind of social gospel? I don't want nothing to do with that. But what I'm trying to say is everybody thinks because of the numbers and because they got money and it glitters with gold and the entertainment's groovy and all that it's God. I told you a couple weeks ago, Jesus came riding on a donkey. He was born in a manger and he anoints the little ruddy-cheeked boy that was a shepherd in the field that fought with rocks. Saul tried to put his own armor on him and tried to make him fight with a sword, a giant. Nobody else can take down the giant. It takes a little boy to show up with a rock in his sling to take him down. In the power and the anointing of God's moving and operation. That's how God moves. He takes the small things, he takes the foolish things to confound the wise. Amen. That's why man and all his wisdom and all his psychology is trying to figure all this stuff out, trying to tell you that you're born of your daddy, an addict, and you'll always be an addict. You're born of your daddy, Adam, in sin, and you'll always be a sinner. You need to give your heart to Jesus and learn how to bow your knee to him. Oh, well, I ain't got that problem, preacher. I never smoked a pipe. Well, hallelujah. Good for that. But you got some kind of problem, and I'll agree with you. Some problems affect other people around them more than other problems do, but it don't mean it's not affecting your life. Amen. Come on. Anyway, I want you to know that the Lamb had seven horns, which is a number of fulfillment and perfection and completion. And the horn has to do with power. Amen? And it also has to do with anointing. And it also has seven eyes, and before we get into Romans, I'm probably won't be too much longer. But before we get into Romans, I just want to make a point that the seven eyes. I'm not even going to turn there because I don't have time. It's not seven spirits. It's seven attributes of the Holy Spirit, and it talks about in Isaiah chapter 11 the seven attributes of the Holy Spirit. The first one is that the Holy Spirit would rest upon him. Talking about the Messiah. Talking about the root of Jesse. That's what it says in Isaiah chapter 11. A branch will come forth. A root of Jesse. Or a rod from Jesse. Who's Jesse? David's daddy. I'm sorry. Yes. Jesse is David's dad. And so Jesse gave birth to David, and David is where the lineage that Jesus originates from. The tribe of Judah, the house of David. He's a king after David. And so what I wanted you to see there, though, is that it says of this promised Messiah that the Spirit would rest upon him. And the Holy Spirit was on Jesus like nobody ever before. And then it also talks about counsel and wisdom and knowledge and the fear of the Lord and power. These are the attributes of the Holy Spirit. But one of the first things I want you to know is that the Holy Spirit rested upon Jesus, but because of Jesus' work at the cross, the Holy Spirit rests upon you, amen? And the same power that Jesus operated in is the same power. He said that the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead will also quicken or bring life to your mortal bodies. The same Spirit that Jesus operated in is the same Spirit that you can operate in. Hallelujah. And listen, it said seven eyes, which are the seven spirits. I was thinking to myself that in those adjectives, it talked about counsel, it talked about wisdom, and it talked about knowledge. And I was thinking to myself, it goes on to say too that the judge, Jesus, it was talking about him 600 years before his birth in Isaiah, that he would not judge according to what his eyes saw or his ears heard. You know, God gave you and I eyes and ears and tactile sensation and taste, olfactory sensation, so we can smell, so that we can navigate in this physical world that we live in. Problem is that many times we make all our decisions based on that. Robert was just saying the other day how so many things in our life can become a distraction to the point where we don't really hear the voice of God anymore. But what the Holy Spirit, what the Word of God says in Isaiah is that the Holy Spirit rested upon Jesus, and that same Spirit that rested upon him can rest upon you and I. And his seven eyes that allows you to see in another realm. Seven eyes gives you counsel and wisdom and knowledge to be able to perceive the spiritual realm. Amen. Yes. The Holy Spirit wants to speak in you and speak to you so that you can navigate not just according to your physical senses. Amen. But that you can navigate according to God's will in the spiritual realm. He wants to speak to you. Hallelujah. And so I just want you to see that there's this closeness between the slain lamb and the Holy Spirit. Lo, behold, a lion, and he turns around and he sees a lamb. Amen? All right, so one of the things that I want to talk to you about is Romans chapter 5, and I'm closing with this. Romans 5, verses 1 and 2. Now, some of you have heard me teach this before. By the way, we're starting a series tonight on Romans. We're going to teach Romans 1 through 8. I'm excited about that. It's going to be good. If you know anybody that desires to understand better how to walk in victory with the Lord, it's going to be, I believe, an enlightening series. But right here it says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. We're about to get deep. Y'all just thought we were deep. That was just all that stuff was superficial. We're talking about a story about people weeping in heaven. That's all we were just doing. We're about to get deep. We need to know, how do I walk with God today? Amen? It says right here, first off, I want you to see there's four parts that I wanted to point out. Therefore, being justified by faith. Now, many of you already know what this means, but just in case you didn't, I want you to know that the word justification, it describes a legal declaration. Now, I'm trying, all this right here, whether you see it yet or not, has to do with the close working between the Holy Spirit and the slain lamb. All right? Just remember that. I'm trying to make sure that I don't lose you in that point. The close working between the Holy Spirit and the slain lamb. I spoke to my nephew Nick one time about this passage of Scripture because I know that sometimes when I talk about the cross, people don't understand what I'm saying. I read this passage of Scripture to him. I said, you don't see the word cross in there, do you? I said, no, you don't, but it's screaming the cross. The reason that you don't see the word cross in there is because you don't understand what the word justification means. The word justified means to be declared legally righteous. To be declared righteous. By who? By God? God says that you're righteous. How does God do such a thing? Well, you really need to know the first three chapters. The first three chapters of Romans explain that all men are guilty according to God's standard of righteousness. Then he introduces us to Jesus, which is the righteousness of God. Mm. Then we're told how that righteousness can be given to man upon his faith in Jesus, and not just Jesus, but the shedding of his blood. So when you put your faith in the righteous one and what he did for you at the cross, now that makes you righteous in the eyes of God. And now God says, you're justified. You're declared righteous by God, not because you did everything right, but instead because by faith you chose to believe the plan of God. Amen? And so that's the first step I need you to understand in the close working of the Holy Spirit along with the slain lamb. You can't be justified unless you put your faith in the slain lamb. That was number one. Number two, the next thing that happens is it allows peace with God. See, before you gave your heart to Jesus and put your faith in what the slain lamb did for you, you weren't at peace with God. There's a war in your soul. You might think you were okay, but you weren't. And that's why there was animosity and chaos, and that's why there was a lack of peace in your life. But if you put your, and you can be a Christian and not know how to submit yourself to the truth of the gospel and still see chaos in your life. When you put your faith in God's plan, which is faith in the slain lamb, he declares you as righteous, and now all of a sudden you feel peace with God.
Yes.
You're not going to do everything right today.
Right.
That doesn't mean you can't have peace in your life. I'm not telling you to go sin. That's not what I'm telling you to do. What I'm trying to tell you is that it's not about your performance. It's about your faith in his performance. Trust in him. Amen. So first you have to be justified by faith, which is all about the slain lamb, which brings peace with God. Then you have access by faith into this grace. See, that's what I wanted you to see that. See the word grace right there? What does grace mean to you? I'm going to define it for you in a second. But I want you to think about that for a second. What does grace mean to you? Most people just think of grace as just simple forgiveness, right? I mean, a lot of people do. God's unmerited favor. You've heard that definition before. I want you to see grace as something a little bit different. I want you to see grace as the Holy Spirit is the one that dispenses grace. Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
That the Holy Spirit is the one that gives grace to man? I mean, in other words, you tell me, who is the person of the Trinity that's working in your life each day as each day goes by? Is Jesus physically in your room with you? I mean, did you see him this morning when you woke up?
No.
Did you feel his presence though?
Yes.
Amen. It's the Holy Spirit. He's the other comforter, right? Isn't that what Jesus said?
Yes.
I'm gonna pray to the Father, he's gonna send another comforter, the one whom the world doesn't know, but you know him, for he's been with you and he will be in you. When you got saved and were declared righteous, the Holy Spirit came to live on the inside of you. Hallelujah. And now the Holy Spirit is the one that's dispensing grace into your life. Grace is power from God to strengthen you and to build you up and give you the strength that you need in order to live right for God, no matter what it is that you're going through. Amen? And so that's what it says, access by faith into this grace wherein we stand. Now, I just put this definition up here. Grace is, number one, yes, it's God's unmerited favor. What does that mean? You can't earn grace. I need you to know that. You can't read enough. You can't go to church enough. You can't pray enough. You can't go to enough Promise Keepers meetings. You can't go to enough program meetings. You can't go to enough church services. You can't put enough oil on your forehead. You can't come up for prayer enough. You can't speak in tongues enough. You can't do nothing enough to earn the grace of God. Can't do it. It had to be purchased. It's free, but it cost Jesus' life.
Amen.
Amen. So it's God's unmerited favor. It's not given to you. Oh, that'll mess somebody up, dude, right there. I'm telling you right now.
What, I don't have to work for it?
Yeah, exactly. And let me tell you said that real sweet and calm, but let me tell you, the Word of God says that for Abraham, it was grievous to tell Ishmael he had to go. Ishmael was a work of the flesh. You understand what that means? God had a plan, and God said, this is the way the plan's going to go. And Abraham said, oh, me and Sarah got another plan. We're going to produce a seed of the flesh. We're going to produce an Ishmael. And God said that lad's got to go. And the Word of God said it was grievous for him, because the religious heart that has built his whole Christianity upon his works and his performance and how much he read and how much he knew and what he could tell somebody else. And when you tell them, it ain't about you or your performance. It's not about your religion. It's about Jesus, the Christ, the slain Lamb of God. Oh, at first, it's like a knife, and it cuts it. goes against everything that you've ever known. But what about me? I've been a good Christian. Word of God says there's none righteous. No, not
right.
God's unmerited favor, number one, you can't earn. Number two, it's a divine influence on the heart and its reflection in the light. You see that word right there? Divine, that means God.
Yes.
Influencing. He's the one stimulating your heart. The heart is the inner man and its reflection. When the Holy Spirit dispenses grace into your life, when you keep your faith in the slain Lamb of God, it gives you access to grace, which is the power of God being dispensed by the Holy Spirit into your life in the midst of your situation. He works on the inside of your heart. He begins to change things on the inside, and the next thing you know, it becomes reflected outwardly. Wendy couldn't say no to the stuff. She said yes to Jesus. Hallelujah. And when you say yes to Jesus, grace flows. I could go on and start naming other people's names up in here. I'm not going to do it because y'all didn't give me permission, but I'm going to ask y'all to give y'all's testimony. Give you testimony to talk about what Jesus did in your life.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Last thing is this, wherein we stand. I don't know about you, but I need standing grace.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Amen. The forces of evil. That's what it says in Ephesians 6. You don't war against flesh and blood, but against principalities. He said, clothe yourself with the full armor of God. We talked about that a while ago. In other words, clothe yourself with Jesus. Amen. That you might be able to withstand. That you might be able to stand against the wiles or the trickery of the devil. Lord, help us. Give us grace, power from on high to strengthen us that we might stand. Amen.
Amen.
I wanted in this last point just to make the point. The close working of the Holy Spirit along with the slain lamb. You cannot separate the two. When your faith is in the finished work of Christ, God is pleased because you're being obedient to the plan that He created. Amen. And now He moves with His power on your behalf.